We can start now. So very good morning, all the participants, head of department, computer engineering. This is Dr. Vipul Mistry, training and placement officer, and along with my team member, Professor Devarsi Nayak, we welcome Mr. Sanket Patel. So today's webinar is on serverless technology. And we are very much fortunate to have Mr. Sanket Patel with us, who has been also the previous TCSian, who has worked in TCS for several years, and who is also a trainer, professional trainer in JavaScripting. So thank you so much, Sanket, for being with us and accepting our invitation for this webinar. I definitely wish that this session will be definitely helpful to our students, and they will get something new, and they can also focus in future with reference to the technologies which will be forecasted by you in this session. So now I will request Professor Devarsi to say something and introduce yourself also. Thank you.
thanks Vipul, it's my pleasure to be here.
Yes.
Hello everyone, it's Devarsi Nayak, assistant professor at SNP IIT and RC. Mr. Sanket is my schoolmate. He's full stack JavaScript developer as well as professional JavaScript trainer. He's having 7+ years of experience in web development. He had worked at TCS before. He's a co-founder at Red Software. I welcome you, Sanket, on behalf of SNP IIT and Computer Science and Engineering Department. Now over to you. Without wasting time, we should focus on serverless technology, right?
Yes. Yeah. Thanks, Devarsi, for introducing. Let's go ahead. So today we are going to talk about the serverless technology, and the title you may see a kind of change, but it's the same thing I want to convey with the title, that you may forget the servers if you go with the serverless technology. So many of you who have published your website to the server or have come across, let's say, a Linux kind of thing, Linux server deployment, server building and server deployment, DevOps technology. So you might have heard this kind of words sometimes before, or let's say you made a simple website for your college or someone, and you hosted that particular website to, let's say, any server. It can be a shared server, it can be a virtual machine or anything, right? So that we all know, right? We have to take many hurdles, and we have to take the files, we have to upload it to somewhere, and we have to manage that server, we have to keep that server live. So all those stuffs, generally we had to make before we had this serverless technology, but now we have serverless, so we can reduce all this stuff and let these cloud providers do all those things for us. So how this go, let's get deep into this particular technology. Yeah, so this is something about myself. I think Devarsi and Vipul already covered. So yeah, I'm Sanket Patel, and I'm a full stack JavaScript developer. And a professional JavaScript trainer. I train junior developers as well as the students for the JavaScript and the hot frameworks of it, let's say React, AngularJS, which are needed now to get a job even as fresher, because obviously we have a too much competition, and in the current scenario where we have a lockdown and many companies trying to reduce their resources. So at that time, this kind of technology you must learn, I would say. Sanket3 is my Twitter handle. I am generally active at twitter.com, and this is the username I have. And you can find more information about me, maybe if you want to read my blogs or any other information, my past projects or anything, you can get those information from sanket3.com. So yeah, what is serverless? So this serverless computing is a cloud computing execution model in which the cloud providers run on the server and dynamically manages the allocation of machine resources. I hope you got that, or you guys are like ranchos who don't understand from the definitions, right? Yeah, let me clear that out and let's deep dive into these definitions, because these definitions generally don't make any sense by just reading it, right? Yeah, okay. So this is how it should be, right? Yeah. Serverless technology is, let's say, for cloud providers, for now you just understand that they are CPUs, okay? So when you work on a serverless technology, the CPUs will be allocated to your application dynamically. So let's say your application generally have 1000 requests per day, okay? So one or two CPU is fine for your application. But let's say on some day, let's say take an example of GPU itself, right? So on GPU, generally people visit, let's say daily they are getting 9 to 10,000 of leaks. But when there is a result, okay, how much load an application will have? Everyone wants to see the results. Sometimes we may want to confirm our results 3-4 times and we try to go there, right? So how much load in a small amount of time that particular application will have? That particular application, I mean a web application, okay? So whenever I will use a term application, take as a web application, an application hosted on a server, okay? So that particular application will have a heavy load at a particular time. Also take an example of India-Pakistan match on and a load on Hotstar, right? So on last some hours, there will be a huge traffic on Hotstar, and that is for some amount of time. Not every time millions of user visits the Hotstar, okay? It's the same as the way the traffic, an uneven traffic we are getting at GPU as well. The same thing applies to IRCTC as well. We all know that IRCTC also have a heavy traffic during Tatkal and opening hours, let's say 9 to 12 or something. So these kind of applications are there. So what exactly happens on these applications? For a specific amount of time, we are getting so much traffic, and for the other times, there is not much traffic, okay? So one solution is, let's say we allocate 50 CPUs. CPUs by main CPU, machine, or memory power, I am saying, or processing power, I am saying. So let's say we always allocate 50 CPUs to our GTU website so that the results will be handled. So let's take a hypothetical example. 10,000 requests are handled with 5 CPUs only. But when there is 50,000 or lakhs of requests, we have to allocate, let's say, 50 CPUs to it. Okay. So one option is we always allocate 50 CPUs, but that cost you more, because many times when there is no result, we don't need that much processing power, right? Because we don't have that many requests. The other option is whenever there is a request, a day before, let's allocate 50 CPUs and then deallocate, okay? But for that, we have to manually do a lot of things. Making CPUs and allocating that CPUs online is not an easy task. We have to test everything, right? We have to load test, because let's say we allocate 50 CPUs and we declare the result, and if the request get failed, then it will be a heavy issues to the students and to the whole university itself, right? So serverless is a technology, and that's what the definition says, right? The cloud providers, or you can say a CPUs, will be dynamically manage the resources. So an amount of request the server gets, it will dynamically add the resources to it, resources by min CPUs and memories to it, so that whenever there is a huge traffic, it will allocate too many resources, too many CPUs. And when there is no traffic, all those extra resources, extra CPUs will be shut down so that we won't be charged for it. Okay. And that's applied to the pricing as well. Pricing is actually based on the resources consumed. Okay. So amount of resources, amount of CPUs being used right now, for that only you will have to pay. As soon as your request gets lower, the CPUs will be shut down and you won't get charged for that thing. Okay. So this is possible with the cloud only. So that's why whatever the CPU in cloud, there is no a dedicated CPU is there, right? The way we have in VM. So that's why we call it a cloud provider. So when you heard a word cloud provider, that means it consists of execution power, that is CPU, as well as memory that it needs to run and store the data whenever your program runs. Okay. So this is what the definition, and this is the bottom line of a serverless technology. So let's go ahead. Yeah. So who all provide this technology, right? So most of the cloud providers now provide this technology. First is AWS, which is very popular. It is by Amazon. Then we have Google Cloud by Google, obviously. Then we have Azure, that is by Microsoft Azure. One is IBM Cloud, and there is also a Cloudflare. So all these providers are there into competition, and they are implementing their technologies into serverless. So they are also trying that their existing technologies, like their existing database, which were not serverless till now, they are also trying to convert it into a serverless framework, so that we all users will be benefited out of it, right? because generally all application need this kind of scenario, that whenever I don't use or whenever I don't have many requests on my server, then I should not be charged for it, right? So how to achieve it? So here is a diagram through which I want to explain you how we can achieve this. So on the very left side, I hope you are getting where I am pointing right now. Oh, let's say I can use this one. Yeah. So here is consider this as you are requesting to the server, and this whole part from here to last thing, this is whole server thing, which is managed by cloud itself automatically. So how it works? Whenever you request anything, the request goes over here. This particular server will try to fetch a function. Function is just, let's say you are requesting something to send an email. Okay. So, or you want to, let's take an example of GTU perspective only so that you will be able to relate it with your daily needs. So let's say you are requesting to get a result of enrollment number 123. Okay. So when you request it, the server will try to find a respective code or a respective function that will pull the result of enrollment number 123. So that they have to pull the whole code, right? The function in which the business logic is written that it should go to this database and it should pull out the result for that user. So the whole business logic is being pulled from a bucket. So over here you can see a bucket. Bucket is just a storage. In cloud terms, we call it bucket. Bucket is where we store our files, our functions, our code, everything. Okay. And from the top, we get a container. Container is also called a cloud provider. Container in which it's a bundle of a processing power and memory. So your function needs to run somewhere, right? So that container will be responsible to run your code, run your business logic, and also allocate some memory if you need. All those stuffs being done by this container. So whenever there is no a continuous server listening right now, we have to understand that, right? So whenever your request occurs, this process will be there. The server will pull the function from storage, a container will be allocated to it, and whatever your request is, it will be written. So this container will execute the function and it will try to get the data from the database, and it will respond you the request. Respond you to that particular request. So result will be displayed on your website. Okay. Now, what other things this particular thing do? This container, whatever we have created, we have function and we have CPU power. So what this will do, it will try to listen for other requests as well. So let's say it will keep this container on till, let's say, some new request occur, then it will directly serve from this container, but it will wait for some time. Let's say 5-10 minutes. If there is no more request is available from the user, then it will directly put it into a sleep mode. So once it gets into the sleep mode, there won't be a charge applied to the users. Okay. So this is what we want to display. A container will be created. It will wait for some time over here. That is there any new request coming up? If request comes up, then it will directly respond to this particular request. If it won't get any request for a small amount of time, then it will put this container into a sleep mode. Once it gets into the sleep mode, there won't be a charge. Okay. So that way the whole functionality under the hood, the whole serverless thing works. Then some of the frameworks we want to see through which framework you can create the serverless application. Because whenever there is a serverless application you want to create, obviously there are some file structure you have to follow. Let's say many of you might be knowing ASP.NET, right? So ASP.NET have a proper file structure in it where I can't recall because I haven't worked much. It was, I think, 7 to 8 years since I have worked on ASP.NET, but there were something like controller views and all those pages were there. We were creating the DAO layer and all those in our college days. That's what I remember. But yeah, you can consider that there is some file structure over there, which you have to follow, and that file structure you have to publish on your server. Okay. So to achieve that thing, there are many frameworks available if you want to write your code in serverless. So there is serverless framework. There is AWS SAM, which is by AWS, obviously. And there is Cloudia.js, that is for JavaScript developers using JavaScript, you can create the whole serverless application. Yeah, and some of the events, when you have this kind of serverless application available, there are many possibilities it opens. So let's say first thing is API gateway is just an URL, you can say, a URL you can hit from your computer to get the data. The same URL you can use to schedule. So using this serverless, you can also schedule your function. Let's say you want to run a job. Let's say you have an application where on Monday morning, you want to send emails to all your users, right? So on Monday morning, you can just specify your particular time. And at that particular time, this schedule will run and it will hit the API and it will send the data. So here also you can consider, right? So if your application send an email on Monday morning only, then why should you buy a server and keep it running every time, right? So better you use this serverless technology. You assign it some time to a function. Let's say on Monday morning, 9 o'clock, it should run. So at that time, this particular function will run. The container will be allocated the way we saw in previous slide. And now after the whole job run, you won't get any request. So the container will be off and you won't be charged. So your billing will be low. The same way you can do, yeah, nowadays also databases. So generally we have thoughts in our mind that if you want to run a SQL server, right, you have to keep a server running, right? It should run always. So that's not the thing nowadays. Obviously the serverless, the SQL server is not implemented with the serverless right now, but there are many other databases available which you can replace the server, your SQL server with this, let's say DynamoDB is there. There is also Firestore by Firebase, which you can use instead of your SQL server. And all these things works on serverless technology only. So whenever you have a heavy traffic, the server will up, the database server will up, and it will serve the purpose. When you don't have traffic, the database server also gets down and shut down. So this is a huge achievement in serverless when you convert your, not only the application, but database itself is also a serverless. So database server will also work only when you need the data. Okay. Also, when you achieve, let's say, when you most of us know Alexa and Google Homes, right? They are also the IoTs, we can say. IoTs are just the sensors which sends the data to the server. Okay. So when we work with that, those Alexa and Google Home Mini can also communicate to the serverless functions and get the response. So let's say you fire a command to Alexa or Google Mini, it will hit the server, the serverless. It will try to get the information related to whatever the command you sent, and it will show you, or it will speak out to you when it is Alexa and Google Home is there, right? So that's way you can use this serverless technology for any kind of request. These are all the requests only, right? So first request is when you call from the local, your browser. Schedule is something server will call to server at a specific amount of time. Third is when you want to use the database. And if there are some requests from the IoT, let's say devices, Alexa and Google Home Mini, that also you can achieve through serverless. Some of the applications, if you want to highlight, yeah. So I already talked about Hotstar, right? So Hotstar is something using this serverless very heavily. When there is an IPL, we must have seen some of the campaign that it runs. I forgot the name of the campaign, but it was something like you have to predict that what will be the next next ball going to be. So will it be going to be a 4, it's 6, it's a 1 run or a dot ball, right? So there was some prediction that we have to make, and they were rewarding if our prediction is correct. Okay. So in that kind of scenarios, they are using this serverless technology very heavily because they need that particular application only when there is an IPL going on. Only 4 hours a day, or let's say 10 hours a day when there is a 2 match, and that too only 1 or 2 months of the whole year itself, right? So they won't be able to afford a dedicated server for this. And we might consider that our small application just charge us let's say 1,000 per month for the server cost, but for Hotstar and all those like application, they have lakhs of billing for a month when they want to cattle this many users, right? So same goes with Flipkart and Amazon as well. There are some Diwali sales. There are also something like when new phone is introduced at, let's say they release that particular phone or they open the booking at 12 a.m. then let's say 12 p.m. then there is a huge traffic that we get at 12 noon, right? So to handle that particular thing as well, there is serverless technology beneficial because we are getting uneven traffic and that particular traffic we are getting at a specific time. So better the cloud itself handle to create all those containers and shut down when there is no request available. We also took an example of IRCTC. IRCTC has a peak time during which they have a lot of users and after that they don't get that many users, right? So to handle that, we can use serverless for that thing as well. Next, yes, why we should use it and where it is suitable for mainly, right? So in what kind of application if you have, then you should go with this serverless technology. So very first application is MVP. MVP is not related to anything related to model view or something like that. It is called for minimum viable product. So in the world of this, in the startup world, we can say, we are generally, previously, what we were doing, let's say around 10, 15 years back, if you want to create any banking application, we were spending years, to 1 or 2 years. When I was in TCS, we were working for one of the US client, we were making an application for them and they were developing that application from 2 years. And when I was there, we took 1 year more and after 3 years, we released the product. Yeah, right. But that is true for the banking application, but for the startup world, let's say Ola, you take Ola, you take any Hotstar even, you take OLX, those kind of applications can't afford to stay for 2 years in the development time. So what they generally do, they make a very basic application. They release it in 3, 4, or 6 months. So when the application is out to user, user will give you feedback, right? User will give them the requirement that now we need this, now we need this. So develop it accordingly, right? So, and that is a better way nowadays in the development as well. Now, whenever, whichever the application we make, we generally keep a focus of 3 months. How much bigger the application is, we release the application in 3, 4, or max 6 months so that the application is out to user and we will get the feedback. We will get, we will have testing and everything because many time it happens, you spend your 2-3 years in an application and after that you will feel that there is no more need of this application. There is a huge competitor already there or we have developed something that actually the user don't want, right? So it wastes all your time. So that's why now newer concept is to make a minimum viable product. Minimum viable product is something that a user can start using. It may not be a full-fledged website, a full-fledged application, but it will be a basic application through which you can get the knowledge and you can interact or you can do a very basic task. Even we can see the, let's say take an example of WhatsApp itself, right? We are seeing that every week there is new thing coming up. It can be a functionality, it can be an inner thing that we can't see from the user, but something is coming up. We can see on the Google Play Store or iPhone Play Store, iOS Store, that there is something, updates are coming up. So that's what they are also doing. They do a beta release, they do for a small amount of user, they release a basic thing. I'll take an example of a very recent thing. They were allowing 4 users on WhatsApp, right? Now they are allowing 8. Why? They got a feedback from the user, right? And they released it. So from initial itself, if WhatsApp thought that I want to allow 100 users on my this application to have a video chat, it won't be possible. So they have to gradually do that. And for that, they generally make an MVP. And when you are developing an MVP, you have a startup idea. Initially, you don't know how much traffic you are going to get, right? And you generally want to see a cost-effective solution where you will be charged little less. So for that, generally, all startups start with an MVP. And let's say you have a startup and you do a campaign kind of thing and suddenly you got a huge traffic, right? So you need something to handle it. You can't, when you are starting up a product and you are in a starting phase, you can't hire a dedicated person to handle these all server management thing, right? So better to handle it to the better to give that responsibility to the cloud itself, so that cloud will manage all those stuff. Okay, and that is dynamically also, it is price effective, so we get both the benefit out of it. Inconsistent usage, as we discussed, ISTC have an inconsistent usage. They don't have traffic all the time. So in that kind of scenario, better to have this kind of serverless technology in place. Events from the different sources, as we said, a same application. Let's say the GTU tomorrow implement a new thing, that from Google Home Mini or Google Assistant or Alexa, you can ask for your result. Okay, so if they want to implement it using serverless, it will be too easy. They just have to configure the Alexa thing to that particular their existing functionality, result fetching functionality, and your result will be available on your Google Assistant as well. Okay, so then some of the application which is using an hybrid cloud provider. So there are many applications, huge applications mainly. They use Google Cloud provider as well, as well as they are using AWS. They might be using IBM for whatever the functionality they are providing, right? To get the best out of all of them. So at that time also, this kind of serverless technology is very much suitable, because you don't have to create a dedicated server. You can just use a specific functionality from a specific cloud provider. There are obviously some limitations, and these limitations are mainly due to this is an evolving technology. It is very new technology. So there are some limitations, and that are going to be fixed. Okay. So yes, when your function or whenever your program is going to take more than 15 minutes, AWS won't allow you to run it. Okay. So your function should finish in 15 minutes. In GCF, in cloud, Google Cloud function, your function should take only 1 minute to run. And on Azure functions, it only allows 5 minutes for your functions to run, right? So very first instance of the function. So let's say you request on GTU for your result. And if that function takes more than 1 minute on Google Cloud, it will drop that function. But on AWS, it is 15 minutes. So up to 15 minutes, your function can run. Generally, in most of the application, it won't take that much time. Otherwise, nowadays, who will wait for 1 minute to get a response, right? It's a 60 seconds. Generally, no one wants to wait for that much time. Okay. And this is enough as well. So the concurrent execution of a function can only live up to 1,000. So 1,000 functions can run. A specific function can run. Its 1,000 instances can run at a time. And deployment package, when you deploy anything on a server, it should not exceed 50 MB. So that's more than enough generally. But there is a limit. Your function should not have an function memory size should not exceed 50 MB. Cons. So there are some the cons as well. There are some disadvantages as well. So where it is not suitable, and rather than disadvantages, they are going to say some of the applications for which this whole serverless technology is not suitable. So which are those applications? Let's say consider one of the application which is anyway going to have a huge traffic all the time. Consider now an API that gives us the data of the coronavirus in particular country, state, or a village or something like that, right? There is a dedicated API. It's an open API which is currently accepting our application, and in return they are replying with number of cases you have. So we can request, let's say, how many cases we have in India. If you want to see the history as well, let's say from 30th January, we reported very first case in India. So they give us the information of history as well. If you want to see it from Surat level or Ahmedabad level, then that is also possible. So that API is currently live all the time, 24/7, right? So those API generally afford to have a dedicated server, because they are anyway going to get traffic at least for this year. Okay. And depending on the current architecture, the second thing is maybe you have developed your current application without using serverless technology. So it might be tough to convert from server application to serverless application. because there are huge changes one have to make. Obviously, many ideas are coming up to convert this thing easily, but it will take time. There is also cold start time we have to consider. So whenever your container ups, so whenever you request anything, there is no continuous server listening right now, right? So whenever there is a new things come up, a new request come up, it takes a fraction of second or sometimes 1 second to boot up that particular container. So it may take a little time initially, but once it is up, all subsequent requests will be solved easily. So there are some workaround. I have used this serverless technology and we are implementing some of the methods through which we can come out of this. Also not suitable for the long running process. So let's say your job takes 1 hour. In banking application, it really takes. Sometimes we feel that what application will take 1 hour, something like that, right? No, but it takes too many time. If someone have heard the video processing and all those, it really takes hours. Even it takes days to process one particular application. So in that kind of scenario, you generally need to have a dedicated server because this kind of serverless functions won't live more than 15 minutes. For now, the testing and debugging the serverless application is a bit tough, but most of the frameworks are coming up with local debugging and all. Previously, even when I first developed my serverless application, I was not having anything to debug at locally. So we generally do debugging in ASP.NET and all, right? So that was not possible with serverless technology initially, but now many emulators are there through which we can do. They are yet not up to the mark the way ASP.NET and all those applications are doing, but yeah, they are improving because it's a new technology, so it will take time to improve. Yes, so that's it. There are some more case studies available on serverless.com/learn/case studies, where you can learn from the other companies how they have implemented serverless technology and how they got benefited. I am going to share one case study very quick because we are almost running out of time. Let me share this. This is shout out. It's just for some of the tools I have used to make this particular presentation. So those are very good. And if you want to take a screenshot, please take it. You may find this helpful. This Noun project where you can find the icons. They are freely available. Slide Carnival, from that only I have got this particular template, whatever slide template you are seeing. And Figma is a tool where you can design. It's just like a Photoshop, but it is available on web as well. So on figma.com, you can do the designing, and those are very easy as compared to Photoshop, in my experience, at least. Yeah, and let's quickly cover one case study. So this is one of the application I recently developed and still working on it. So this is completely on serverless. And as you can see, this is an application for the game makers. So let's say one of you are game makers, then you can register your game over here. You can display the progress, let's say what you are going to make, what is the progress. Let's say I am just displaying you WIP over. WIP stands for work in progress. So you can publish, let's say I designed this particular screen today, then I can post it so that everyone will get to know about this progress. And if someone wants to discuss about this, if I want to get some information, if I want to get help, then all you can get from this particular application. So mainly what thing I want to say over here is this application is right now having 240 plus users. Every day 50 users are coming into this and working, and they are using this website. Still, the application server cost is ₹0. Okay. The infrastructure cost is zero just because we are using serverless. And still we are predicting that even if we will have, let's say, 300 to 400 users, we won't be charged. And that's good, right? If you want to try anything out, you can almost have a zero costing. All you have need to spend time on development, but the server cost will be zero. Obviously, if we have to pay for this domain name, bmake.games, but that's a different thing, right? Server and processing power is free of charge. So this is what the application I wanted to discuss. And you can also read many case studies. Let me go further. At the end, I would like to have feedback. Let me post this particular form link on this chat box. I will really need this feedback so that I can improve myself as well as a few further things. Let me see whether, okay, I'm posting it to everyone. So you will find a form link through which you can give feedback to me, and that would be really helpful to give. And yes, one more thing I want to say, in feedback form I haven't asked for any name, email or anything. I want to have that as honest as possible. Whatever you feel, write it. I won't have any information of you. But there is also a newsletter. Once you submit that feedback form, there is a newsletter. So if you want to get updates from me, anything related to new technologies, my blog or anything, if you want to keep updated, then there will be a new link you will get after you submit a feedback form. Please fill that out as well. And meanwhile, let's also have a question. So those who want to fill, that they can fill. And if someone have a question, then just raise your hand or unmute yourself so that we can take questions as well. Meanwhile, the other, please fill the feedback form. Yes, if any questions, they can raise your hand.
Yes, please, anyone, if you are having question, please raise.
I hope you got the point.
Dear students, Mr. Sanket is still with us. If there are any queries related to these, or maybe if you would like to ask anything, something else.
Yeah, anything.
So he's there with us.
Yeah, related to any career or something like that.
Yes, yes, anything. Just feel free to ask.
Yeah. I think I have forgot to mention the email address. Let me just show it on a notepad maybe right now. So if you want to reach out to me, that is also possible. Okay, so I have just shared this email address here. So on Twitter, on email address, wherever you want to, and if you want to take screenshot of this,
so everyone has completed the feedback, right? So thank you, Sanket, to briefly lighten on cloud-based server technology. Hope we will connect again in future.
Yes, sure. And,
I hope everyone present in this webinar will practically perform this at their end.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for accepting my invitation.
Thanks. That was my pleasure. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. And yeah, any students or faculty, if you need any more information or any practical scenario, if you want to discuss or want to implement, please let me know through any of these contact details. I would be happy to share.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.